Hi, welcome to Peaceworks. I'm Heather Gallion. In this episode, we're going to hear from Bruxy Cavey. And we asked some people this question. What did Jesus mean when he said, "Blessed are the peacemakers"?
Yeah, I think he's just prompting people to become peacemakers. And he's saying that if you are making peace, you have his blessing and you are fulfilling what he wants to be done on this earth. And that's one of his main points. So
I think Jesus meant the people that are out working for those that don't have anyone looking out for the best interest. I think he meant that the people that are doing that work, looking out for the oppressed and the people living on the margins of society, whatever that may be, those people are really going to receive a blessing because they're doing work that is overlooked by a ton of people.
I think it's just straightforward. I think it's that God wants peace on earth. And so if you live your life out to make the world more peaceful in a little way or a big way, God will bless you for that.
Let's see what some others had to say about that.
And as we have learned, when Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers," he doesn't mean peacemaker the way we often mean it in our culture today, meaning those who will use any means necessary to achieve peace as the end goal. He means peace as a way of life. He means those who will work for peace by using the means of peace. A peacemaker, as he will go on to explain in context, and that's what we'll look at today in the Sermon on the Mount, a peacemaker is someone who will, through peaceful means, work for reconciliation, work for a unity that this world has not yet experienced outside of the kingdom of Christ. And he says, "Blessed are the peacemakers," for what? He says, "For they will be called the children of God." They'll be called the children of God. Do you want to be a child of God? He says, be a peacemaker. Now, what's interesting is he goes on in the Sermon on the Mount to say, if you want to be perfect like your Father is perfect, if you really want to be like God, be a peacemaker. And he will give us very practical examples on how to do that. And it is the only place in the teaching of Jesus where Jesus tells us how to be like God. You see, throughout his teaching and throughout the rest of Scripture, we are called to be like Christ. He is our mentor. He says, "Follow me, learn from me, take my yoke upon you." And in the New Testament, we're called to be conformed to the image of Christ. This is the only place in the teaching of Jesus where Jesus says, "Now I'm going to teach you how to be like God himself. I'm going to teach you how to have his heart, the essence of who he is. This is the closest you will ever get to living the divine-like life. And he teaches enemy love. He teaches how to love indiscriminately, to pour out your blessing upon both the just and the unjust, just as God showers down his rain and his sunshine. You see your notes? We want to look at the red letters. Now, the red letters is kind of a short form within Christian circles to mean the teaching of Jesus specifically. Some publishers publish the words of Christ in red ink in their Bibles. And so as you open up your Bible to Matthew chapter 5 and look there, it might be a page filled with red, or it might not be the case. Either way, when Christians talk about the red letters, they're talking about the centrality of the teachings of Jesus. And as we learned last week, Anabaptists have said this from the start, that the Bible is not a flat book. Remember, Myron Augsburger was talking about this, where we just pick and choose equally from different parts of the Bible and make them compete one for another. But Jesus is the hermeneutical key that helps us understand all of Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament. It all drives toward him. Let's open up our Bibles and read those red letters. You have them in front of you. And as you do, I just want to let you know how Jesus ends the Sermon on the Mount. We've done a series on this, and so many of you will recall that he ends the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 7 by saying, "Therefore, in light of everything that he has taught, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock." Everyone who hears these words of mine and put them into practice is like a wise man who builds his house on the rock. That's how he ends the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 7. Now, notice Jesus is not contrasting people who are Christians and people who have never heard the gospel. He's contrasting people who all show up, who all pay attention, who are all there in his audience, who all sign up, who all maybe join the institution, who maybe even carry a Bible around with them, who maybe even call themselves Christians, who listen to the teaching. There are those who sign up, who show up, but those who hear and do not put into practice versus those who do put into practice. And he says it is those who hear these words and act on them who are building their lives on the rock. It's not enough just to craft a theology. It's not enough just to study. It's not enough just to show up. The question is, are you actually living out what he has to say? Then you're building your house on the rock instead of on shifting sand. So what does he say? Now let's back up to Matthew chapter 5, where he has said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, you're the children of God." And then he goes on to say this, starting at Matthew 5, verse 38. Matthew 5, verse 38. "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you," stop right there. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say to you, there's a couple of things to notice right off the bat. Jesus is contrasting. You have heard that it was said, but I tell you. You have heard that it was taught, but I tell you. He says this repeatedly in this chapter of the Sermon on the Mount over a number of issues. You have heard that it was done this way. Now I am giving you a new way of doing things. There is going to be a change with the coming of Christ. If not, why did he come? He is bringing us into a new way of living, into the new covenant. But I tell you, we're turning a corner. Expect something new now. So if you have this eye for eye, tooth for tooth business coming up, which is very cultural, which would qualify us to be good Canadians, just not good Christians, to say, well, it's only fair to fight for justice and to make sure everything, I will treat you nicely until you disrespect me. Then I'm going to let you know who. Well, that makes you a good Canadian. Doesn't qualify you as a good Christian. Eye for eye, tooth for tooth, that's how it was, but I tell you. Now what does he say? I say to you, do not resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other also. If anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, let that person have your coat as well. Whoever forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2. Give to whoever asks, and don't turn away from anyone who wants to borrow from you. He gives us a number of examples. Let's look at some of them. First of all, I want you to notice that in these examples, he is not encouraging pacifism if by that you think pacifism equals passivity. Remember, to keep things clear, Jesus is not teaching inaction. He does not teach, if someone slaps you on the cheek, let them. If someone wants to sue you, let them. If someone wants to force you to carry their gear 1 mile, let them. Instead, he gives us active, creative, but nonviolent, peaceful ways of responding that will hopefully in each situation generate teaching moments, moments of potential aha, moments of potential enlightenment, moments of potential realization that we are human beings here and can treat each other better than this. Now, in those moments that we offer aggressors, it doesn't mean that they will necessarily be defused by this. This is not primarily just a crafty technique for diffusing hostility, although it may do that. The other person still has a choice how to respond. They still may proceed in their aggression against you, but you have creatively offered them an opportunity to repent, an opportunity to at least begin to see the situation differently. That's what we offer people. Aha moments, potential moments of realization. In the first one, someone slaps you, you turn to them. You see, active but nonviolently creating a potential moment of realization. You turn to them the other cheek. Now, it's interesting because he points out the right cheek. Do you see that in the text? He doesn't just say if someone slaps you on the cheek, turn the other cheek. He says specifically the right cheek. Why? One thing we do know in ancient texts, as far as which hand they're hitting with, it would be the right hand. Ancient texts, unless otherwise stated, assume the right hand. The left hand, because in some ancient cultures, sometimes left-handers are considered somehow cursed or something. Now, the Bible doesn't say that, but in ancient cultures, lefties, are considered just weird. So the right hand is just assumed. In some ancient cultures, as in some today, the left hand is the poo-poo hand, right? It is just not the normal hand of discourse. So when the Bible speaks of a hand, it is assuming the right hand. If someone hits you on the right cheek, so now let's say I'm aggressing against you and I'm going to hit you on your right cheek. So that's on that side. There we are, looking at close up on camera too. All right, so that's this side, and I'm going to hit, how do I hit you with my right hand? Well, he's obviously describing a backhanded slap. This is the slap of superiority. It is the backhanded slap of the master to the slave, of someone who is trapped in the paradigm of their earthly kingdom and cannot see things according to the heavenly kingdom of Christ, who is trapped in the role play of master versus slave. We are not two human beings made in the image of God. I am superior to you, and I can give you one of these. By turning the other cheek, we're actually saying, if you're going to hit me at least human being to human being. Now, whether it's a punch or a slap, you don't need to dismiss me this way. At least now acknowledge that you are a human being and I am a human being. Now what are you going to do? Again, it may disarm the hostility, it may provoke the hostility, but either way it gives a potential moment of aha, of realization. We can break out of the mold of role play here and say, human being to human being made in the image of God, what are you going to do about it? If someone wants to sue you and take your coat, give them your shirt as well. It's interesting, because within Hebrew culture, you only had those two articles of clothing. And they didn't wear undies. So you wait till they take you to court. He says, they take you to court, and they want the shirt off your back, and you give them that, and you give them your coat. You take off the one thing that they're suing for, and you give them everything. Now you are standing there naked. Jesus is advocating public nudity. This is streaking with a cause. Yeah. Some of us are less likely to get sued than others, I realize now. He's advocating public nudity, and this is the interesting thing. Within Jewish culture, nakedness is a shame. It shames someone, but what is interesting is it shames the person who sees it, not the person who's naked. Within Old Testament stories, we find that someone who looks upon another person's nakedness is the one who's shamed. This is true with the story of Noah, who gets drunk and lies naked in his tent. And the son that comes in and sees his nakedness is shamed and punished for it. It is the sons who back in and make sure they don't look upon his nakedness and cover him over that are then blessed for their response. Nobody comments on whether Noah should have been drunk and naked in the first place. It is one who sees the nakedness that is shamed by it. And so in this case, once again saying, if you are so desperate for my coat, you must need my shirt as well. If a Roman soldier, we learn from this context, forces you to carry his gear for a mile, because that was actually Roman law. It was a militaristic law. It was a law of limitation. A Roman soldier was only allowed to force any civilian to carry his gear for 1 mile. And at the end of that mile, he had to then switch civilians and find another civilian and get them to carry his gear. It was a limiting law for those countries where Roman soldiers were the occupying force. And so Jesus says, if you are one of those civilians who get caught up in that situation where your enemy, who you want to hate and despise, who you want to attack and to sabotage, if they, your oppressor, forces you to carry their gear for a mile, when you get to the end of that mile, what do? You carry it another mile. You see, the first mile is slavery, the second mile is freedom. The first mile is according to the constructs of the earthly kingdom. Rome versus Israel. Roman versus Jew. Oppressor versus the oppressed. It is according to the constructs and the role play of earthly kingdoms and earthly ways of living. The second mile breaks out of that. The second mile gets out of the earthly kingdom mentality into the heavenly kingdom mentality and says, I am no longer Jew versus Roman. I am no longer the oppressed versus the oppressor. I am no longer the powerless versus the person in power. We are now human beings. And as a fellow human being, I choose to help you. As a fellow human being now, I choose to carry your gear. I choose to show mercy and grace. I choose to go beyond justice to compassion. That second mile gives not only a moment of realization or a potential aha to the Roman soldier, it gives a whole mile's conversation worth. And what's also interesting is, remember, the Roman code of conduct was a limiting factor to 1 mile. The Roman is now breaking his own law, going the second mile. You can picture getting to the end and him saying, all right, give me the gear, I'll get somebody else. You say, no, I'll keep carrying it. And he's going, well, I don't want my superior to see. Could you? No, give it back. It's okay. Come on, please. Right? And you're saying, no, because right now, it's okay. I'll vouch for you. You're not victimizing me. You see, now I'm a human being, and so are you. We have just broken out of our roles that our earthly kingdoms tell us to play. And we are behaving as human beings, and as a human being, I'm going to love you. This is powerful and transformative. Look at verse 43 and onward. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. The Old Testament said, love your neighbor. It didn't say hate your enemy, but that was filled in by the tradition at the time. Because it said, love your neighbor. What else are you going to do with your enemies? Jesus says, well, you've heard this, but you know what? Loving your neighbor doesn't go far enough. I'm now telling you, but I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you so that you may be children of your Father who is in heaven. For he causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good. He sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? Hey, you love me, I love you back. I'm a good person, you're a good person. We're respectful to each other, that's great. But don't you dare. No. He says, no, you're just behaving like everyone else who's considered a decent citizen of your nation. Love people who love you back. That's great. But I'm calling you to something more than that. Verse 47, if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Therefore, you are to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. And within context, this is the perfection of indiscriminate love that God models for us directly, even through nature. When it rains and when the sun is out, we say, this is an example. Nature itself models for me how I am to love everyone indiscriminately. And this calls us way beyond being a good citizen of our culture, of our country, to becoming a citizen of a way of living, of a kingdom that transcends nationalistic norms, where we get along with people who get along with us, and we aggress back against people who aggress against us. He says, if that's how you live, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, if the just war is your approach to life, how are you living any differently than any other good and decent citizen of your country? You graduated to being a good Canadian, not a good Christian. I'm calling you to an ethic that goes so far beyond that. Good and decent people will look at you and say, that's just foolish. It's poppycock. And in fact, the Apostle Paul has to come up and sweep up the mess afterwards with understanding, saying, you know, it's kind of right. We follow a way that's considered foolish by others. I mean, ultimately, the greatest victory is through the cross, where Jesus lives out what he's been teaching us, and then we're supposed to carry our own cross, and that's how we conquer. I know, even the good and decent, the wise people of this world are going to look at us and say, that's ridiculous. And we'll say, yeah. Unless you are fully committed to the upside-down kingdom of Christ, it is. According to earthly standards, even for the good people, it is. He's not calling us just to be good and decent citizens. He's calling us to be loving, Christ-like imitators of God himself. This is radical. And it's clear. In the Sermon on the Plain, which is Luke's parallel of this teaching, we read this in Luke 6, 27 and 28. Jesus says, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. Love your enemies is the overarching principle. And then he gives us three practical ways to do that. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. Think of how that could transform our relationships with individuals who are hostile towards Christians. Think of how it could transform the church's collectively relationship with other groups within our society who, when they look at us, rightly or wrongly, say, you guys are a bunch of hypocritical wingnuts. You are so judgmental and so mean-spirited. I want nothing to do with you. And it doesn't mean we agree. Philosophically, we might be enemies. Jesus grants that and says you are two groups of people who are fighting for completely different causes that are at odds. Consider them your enemy. Go ahead, and I'll teach you how to love them. Now, when you're aware of that group out there, you go and start serving them, serving them, serving them. That's our first step. Wow. Is that what the church is doing today? Can I ask you a question, just to be honest about your own mental processing right now? Because I know you've been doing it so far in the series, and you're going to continue to do it, and you're doing it right now. You're saying, yeah, but what about this? And I can't believe Jesus said that. And then over here he said, but I don't think that. He can't actually mean that you should be nonviolent in every situation, because let me just ask you this. Be honest. If theoretically, work with me on this, just theoretically, Jesus wanted to teach pacifism, that is, not in being passive, but in being a peace-making, peace-living person. If he wanted to teach pacifism for his followers, is there anything more he could have said to convince you? Because if not, we might as well just admit that you have a bias and nothing Jesus is going to say or do will change it. Your mind's made up. Because when I read this, I can't even imagine what more Jesus could have said to be more clear. He gives us the principle of loving our enemies, and then he workshops it by giving us specific examples of real life killing, torturing, murdering enemies, and teaches us how to bless them through our actions and our attitudes. And then he wraps it up by saying, look, be like your Father by loving indiscriminately, actively, the good and the bad, the just and the unjust. Is there any more he could say, giving the principle and giving the specifics that could convince you? Because I don't know what else he could say.
Dressed in wine. If you had a part of me, will creature, I have called you son.